Good morning, students. In continuation to instrumental methods of analysis, today's discussion comes under optical measurements. One is already over, that is colorimetry. Second one is flame photometry. So flame photometry, let us look into it. It is defined as, it is the emission of a characteristic radiation by element and the correlation of the emission intensity with the concentration of the element. This is the basis of flame photometry. In order to do this measurement, we need a device called flame photometer. It is a device which is used in inorganic chemical analysis to determine the concentration of certain metal ions like sodium, potassium, lithium, calcium, etc. In periodic table, the group 1 and group 2 metals, that is alkali and alkaline earth metals, which are quite sensitive to flame photometry because of their low ionization energies, that is low excitation energies. Hence, flame photometry is applicable for elements that are easily excited and do not require very high temperature, because we are, for the excitation of these elements, we are using the flame. With the help of flame, we are doing that, will not be having very much high temperature. Okay, so here, let us look into the principle of flame photometry. What is this flame photometry, to explain briefly? It relies on the following fact. What is that? The compounds of the alkali and alkaline earth metals can be thermally dissociated in flame, in presence of flame. Some of the atoms that are produced will be further excited to higher energy level by absorption of the thermal energy, not light energy here, thermal energy. So now when these excited atoms return to the ground state, this is characterized by emission of a characteristic radiation which comes in the visible region of the spectrum. Okay, each element will emit radiation at a wavelength specific for that element, characteristic wavelength for that element. The measurement of the emitted radiation forms the basis of flame photometry. I hope you understood. And in continuation here, I would like to recall your previous knowledge on inorganic qualitative analysis, which you have carried out in your plus two. What you have done there, you have taken a paste of some inorganic salt which is given to you in examination, and that you are making the paste of it on the watch glass with the help of the glass rod. You are, you know, bringing that near to the flame. There, if it imparts certain color, you will be identifying so and so element is present. For example, if lithium is present red color, calcium is present orange color, if sodium is present yellow color, like this you have already come across with the qualitative part of this experiment, what I am going to explain today. So here, let us look into the theoretical part, principle behind this flame photometer measurement, which we take up in this discussion. Here, the element which you are analyzing, that should be made in the form of, prepared in the form of suitable salt solution. Okay, and that is aspirated into the flame. The following series of changes will take place at the flame. What happens? So when you aspirate, that solution containing MX, that is M stands for metal ion, X stands for halide ion. So that will be converted into form of mist. Mist means just like the small droplets, smallest droplets. So when these smallest droplets comes, as they are comes in contact with the flame, thermal energy, it will be get evaporated. What evaporation? It means the salt which is present in your solution will be left behind by the evaporation of the solvent present in it. And it converts into MX solid. Okay, here MX was there in solution. No? Now it becomes MX solid. It means the water content, solvent content in that is evaporated when it is brought in contact with flame. Now in the flame, all this series of reactions will be, changes will be taking place in presence of flame only. Now once this solid is formed again, as it is in thermal energy contact, it will be vaporized. It means that solid MX will be converted into gaseous state, and that gaseous state undergoes now dissociation. Atoms, it will be split into its atomic species. Now this atomic species, in that metal, as it is having the characteristic property of absorbing the thermal energy, it absorbs the heat energy and it gets excited to M star. M star means represents the excited state of these metal atoms. When this excited state is attained, as this is unstable in nature, always these metal atoms will be coming back to ground state by the emission of certain characteristic radiation pertaining to that element. That is what the basis of this flame photometry. It means how much flame light radiation is emitted from this M star to ground state depends on how much atoms present in it. In turn, how much concentration of this solution you have taken. Based on that, this estimation, this determination is carried out. Let us look into the instrumentation part of it. Here, this instrumentation part contains here, the sample is aspirated into the nebulizer. The sample is aspirated into the nebulizer. It means the sample what you have prepared, that will be poured into small beaker with the help of this capillary. You are aspirating into this nebulizer. What is this nebulizer? Here it converts this liquid sample into mist form. So when it is aspirated, it comes to the nebulizer, and here liquid sample converted into the form of mist, and it is sent to the mixing chamber. Okay, now here, for the purpose of producing the flame, we require fuel and air. Now air is passed in the form of compressed form, and with the jet of these gases in the mixing chamber, along with the atoms present in it, molecules present in the form of mist, is now sent to flame. It goes into the flame. Okay, when this sample is sprayed over the flame, what are all the series of changes I mentioned in the principal part? This is what you are seeing now. All these series of changes will be happening in presence of this flame. Okay, when it is sent to this one. Okay, now all this happens in this flame. Now once excitation is taking place, and the ground state is also there, it means it is accompanied by the emission of certain kind of radiation characteristic to that particular element. When that radiation is emitted, now this part is having the recording device, okay, recording purpose. What about the other part? Here also the atoms, when they come back to the ground state, they also emit, and their radiation may scatter from this flame region to the other side, opposite side. That's why a concave mirror is kept. This concave mirror, it reflects the emitted radiation coming from this M star to M gas, M state, okay, that will be coming from this side, will be reflected, and it is sent, and from here also it goes and it falls on this lens, and it reaches here the monochromator. Okay, and here the monochromator, why we are providing this monochromator? The monochromator role is because when we are analyzing samples, for any sample, it may contain many number of elements. Okay, for example, if you are analyzing for water sample, there it may contain sodium, calcium, potassium, etc. When all these atoms present in the sample solution, when they get excited, here each one will emit its own characteristic radiation. Okay, when these are emitting, so you need to analyze for only one element, not all elements at a time. That is why we need the help of this monochromator. So this monochromator, at a time, it will select only one wavelength. That is why we are keeping this monochromator. This monochromator, we need to choose the particular characteristic wavelength. For example, if we are analyzing for sodium, then here we will be fixing the filter number 589 nanometer, that is suitable. That is the relevant for sodium metal. Okay,
Now the monochromator absorbs all other radiations coming, if at all, if the sample contains other elements, that will be cut off. Okay, this monochromator absorbs all other radiation other than the element which you are analyzing. Okay, so the one we are analyzing, that only will come out of this monochromator. That is, if you are fixing for sodium 589, if it is for potassium analyzing 766 nm, if you are analyzing for lithium 670 nanometer, if you are analyzing for calcium 622 nanometer, and if you are analyzing for 589, that is sodium, it is 589 nanometer. Like this you will be fixing each monochromator, that is filter, of particular to that element. Now other radiations will cut off, and the wavelength, and this filter will allow only that wavelength, selected wavelength. Okay, now depending on the intensity of the emitted light, the detector, that is photocell or photodiode, it will detect the intensity of the emitted light coming out of this monochromator, okay, which is falling on this detector. Now there it generates the current. Now the magnitude of current produced at this detector is directly proportional to the concentration of the solution you are taking. It means how much concentration is there, that will decide how much current is produced at this photodiode or photocell. It detects the intensity of the emitted light and generates the current, which is proportional to the concentration. Hence, higher is the concentration, then higher will be the meter reading. Okay, so that is what the overall instrumentation part of it. Now let us look into the each one which is there coming in the instrumentation part. Burner. Here the burner, which is having air and fuel, okay, which combines in the burner system, which produces the flame. And nebulizer and mixing chamber. Here this one converts the liquid sample into mist and sprays the fine particles, fine droplets, into the flame using the compressed jet of gases, that is fuel and air. With this help, it will be bringing to that state. And then monochromator or filter. Okay, filter means which element you are analyzing, that particular filter is kept. Like for sodium, one filter, for potassium, one filter. Like that, for each element one filter will be there kept here. So this allows only the chosen selected wavelength and absorbs cut off all the other radiations. For this purpose the monochromator, it may be prism or diffraction grating, etc. And detector. So this is the detector. So this detects the intensity of the emitted light coming out of the cell and generates the current proportional to it. Okay, here photocell or photodiode, as I already mentioned. And meter, it displays the intensity of the emitted light. Higher the concentration, higher the intensity of the emitted light. Means if your solution containing more concentration, then more intensity of the emitted light will come out with these atoms, and higher is the meter reading. So likewise, it is connected to this measurement. This is with respect to instrumentation. Now let us look into the application part of it. So for example, if you are analyzing for sodium, now you have taken the sodium solution which we have prepared, okay, present in the water. So for that, we need to go with the standard calibration method, like you have done in case of colorimetry. Here also you need to make a calibration curve or standard curve method. So for that, you need to prepare a standard stock solution of sodium of 1 ppm. From this, you need to transfer 2, 4, 6, 8 and 10, etc. Like this, how much concentration you want, how much series of solution you want, like that you need to prepare it and put it into each volumetric flask of 50 ml capacity, and that it need to be made up to the mark using distilled water. Okay, and make up the volumetric flask containing unknown concentration. It means here, for example, here one sample you have, where you need to determine how much sodium is present in it. For that, this is another flask. Like in your colorimetry, here also one unknown flask will be named, in that you are taking that sample solution, okay, containing unknown concentration, and that is also diluted up to mark. And now you need to place the filter, that is sodium. You are analyzing for sodium, no? 589 nanometer, that is kept in the position. And now you need to dip the capillary here. Dip the capillary in first water. Here it is mentioned as sample when you are analyzing for sample. Now here you need to put water, distilled water. And while making this, when it is coming through this way and it is going out of all this flame, and the reading of this flame photometer need to be adjusted to zero because it does not contain any other ion. Next, you need to take one more standard solution of 100 ppm concentration of NaCl solution, and that also need to be put in this small beaker, separate beaker. Every time you can take separate beaker in order to avoid the interference of the other in between concentrations. Okay, so you need to take one standard solution containing 100 ppm sodium chloride, and that need to be put in this beaker, and that need to be aspirated, and that reading you need to adjust it to 100 standard. Okay, for 100 ppm, 100 you are setting. It means between 0 to 100 your analysis is lying. Okay, like that you are setting the standard. Now after this is over, now for every solution what you have prepared, 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10 ml of the standard sodium ion solutions, that you need to take individually one by one, one after the other. Feed the various sodium ion solutions through the flame one by one, including the unknown solution. And every time you need to run this for each solution. And if it is better to take three trials, like in order to get the accuracy, one solution you are pouring, no, that you have taken one reading. So same way, even using the same solution, one more reading, one more, like this, three readings need to be taken for each solution. Okay, like this for 4 ml added, then 6, like this for all this, including this sample solution, sample where you need to determine the unknown concentration of the sodium. That is also need to be run separately, one after the other. Okay, so and note down the reading. Okay, like this, volume of the NaCl, like this, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 is there, no? Like this, some more columns will come, some more rows will come, and concentration in each. Then emission response. After recording each reading, emission response will come, no? How much radiation is coming out, that we need to record it for all this. Okay. Now, the next is, you need to plot the calibration graph, calibration curve. By taking this emission response along y-axis and volume or concentration of this sodium ion along x-axis. If you mark all the points with respect to this, each emission response of each sample solution, like 2, 4, 6, 8. So you need to mark all this on this graph, and you need to draw with a straight line taking all these maximum points. And for this unknown concentration where the sample you need to analyze, you don't know how much concentration is present, but that you have diluted suitable within your working range, that emission response of this unknown concentration also comes between this range what you have prepared, between this 0 to within 10, how much you have prepared, no? In that range only the concentration of the unknown also comes. Now for example, you don't know the concentration of unknown here, so then you already measured the emission response. That emission response you need to mark it on y-axis. From there you need to draw one more line to intersect this straight line connecting all these points, and from intersection again you draw one more line to this x-axis ordinate. It will give the how much concentration of sodium ion is present in your sample, that is, it may be water sample or any other sample you are analyzing. Then you will be coming to know how much concentration of sodium is present. So you record the result of this experiment, how much sodium is present in the given water sample. If you are analyzing for sodium, if you are analyzing for potassium, this will not come for potassium. Similarly, potassium chloride solution you need to prepare instead of sodium chloride solution in the previous experimental part I explained, no? NaCl solution standard 1 ppm, here KCl solution you need to prepare. Like that, each element, whichever the element you are analyzing, that standard solution need to be prepared, and ultimately you need to write the result. Let us look into the applications, uses of this flame photometry. So it is used for qualitative analysis of sample by comparison of spectral emission wavelengths with that of the standards. For quantitative analysis to determine the concentration of group A, first A and second A, that is alkali and alkaline element, alkali and alkaline earth metals elements. For example, concentration of calcium in hard water. If your hard water contains how much calcium is exclusively, you need to analyze, means you can take it. Okay. Concentration of sodium or potassium present in urine or body fluid, etc., in biological fluids samples. Concentration of calcium and other elements in biological body fluids and even in glass melt also, in the glass manufacturing industries and even in ceramic making industries, how much these elements concentration are present, even that also can be analyzed. Okay, that is the application use of this in the flame photometry. Let us look, apart from these advantages, it is also having disadvantages. What is that? Let us look into it. Because here we are using natural gas and air to generate the flame, which is employed for the excitation. Okay, the temperature is not enough to excite transition metals. I already mentioned here, alkali and alkaline earth metals only suitable for this, but whereas transition metals, you cannot do it because they do require higher temperature for the excitation. Therefore, this method is selective only towards alkali and alkaline earth metals. And the second one is low temperature renders this method susceptible to certain disadvantages, which are related to stability of the flame and aspiration conditions, fuel and oxidant flow rate and purity, aspiration rates, solution viscosity, which affect this, etc. Okay. So this whole analysis depends on the flow rate of the fuel, oxidant, and rate of introduction of the sample and droplet size also. So like this, the disadvantages. And next is relatively low energy available from the flame leads to relatively low intensity of the radiation from the metal atoms compared to those metal atoms that require, that demand larger amount of energy, thermal energy, to become excited. And another one is, if the sample you are analyzing with this method, if it is present in smaller amount during aspiration and all, due to this flame pressure, you are supplying, so it may escape off. So if the sample is present in lesser amount, it may be lost during the aspiration because it will be smaller volume, no? Smaller, that to smaller concentration, it may be lost. That is the disadvantage of this flame photometry. So this completes the flame photometric analysis, flame photometry discussion.